My pranams to all Atma Jyotis, divine light of the self. Today's talk is about the stages of awakening. What is the stages of awakening? Can awakening happen suddenly? Or there are some stages in that? If there are stages in that, what are the stages? So this is a question we are addressing. One person came to Buddha and asked him, people call you Bhagavan Buddha. Are you God? Buddha said, no. Then are you a monk? Buddha said, no. Are you a human being? Buddha said, no. Then he asked Buddha, if you are not a god, you are not a human being, you are not a monk, what are you? Buddha said, I am the awakened one. He said, I am the awakened one. Not a god, not a human being, not a monk. So what is this awakening all about? We live in the illusion of a self. We live in the illusion of a self-identity. We start thinking that that's what we are. We start believing that we are our identity. There are many roles we play in our life. An engineer, a doctor, a mother, a father. So there are many, many roles. These are roles. The roles keep changing. But I don't change. I am the one who is playing the role. This we forget. We start believing that we are the identities. So we create an illusion of something called self. There is an illusion of an entity called self based on our transactions. It can be a job, it can be a function, okay, it can be a man, a woman, a nation, a caste, a community. We start creating an identity and we start believing that we are the identity. So these are all required for social interactions, but that's not what we are. So, but once we start believing that we are those identities, an illusion of a self is created. An illusionary self, because it's not real. Today you are an engineer, tomorrow you are not an engineer. Today you are a mother, tomorrow you are not. Okay? So these roles will keep on changing, the social identities keep changing, but I start believing that I am this identity, and this is called illusion of a self. So where did the illusion of self come into picture? The illusion of self came when I started believing that I am the body, I am the mind, I am the intellect. So I have a deep-rooted belief that I am the body, I am the mind, I am the intellect. Even these, I am the body, I am the mind, I am the intellect. Even these are temporary identification. They are not permanent. They appear and disappear. Your body itself keeps on undergoing change from the birth to death. After death, it is not there. Your mind itself continuously undergoes changes. Your intellect also undergoes continuous changes. So now in this continuous changing thing, you start making an identity out of that and start holding on to that identity. So that becomes a suffering for us. Anything we hold becomes a suffering. Suppose I believe, deeply believe that I am the body. Anything happening to the body causes tremendous amount of suffering to me. I cannot accept that the body can become old, body can have disease, body it can go die. I cannot accept. But that's the law of nature. What is constantly changing, continuously changing, you are holding on to that as a permanent identity. It is totally against nature. So there we create a notional or illusionary self. Holding on to the illusionary self is a tremendous amount of suffering for us. We try to struggle to hold on to that identity at whatever cost. But that identity is very fluid, it keeps changing. If you look at any identity what we have, it is very, very fluid, it keeps changing. So now, this holding on to this identity which is illusory. Why it is illusory? Because you need an identity for a purpose, for a transaction. But that cannot be a permanent identity. Identities keep changing. You cannot hold on to it as anything as a permanent identity. Today I have a job. I call myself as engineer. Tomorrow I don't have a job. I am not no longer an engineer. But if my identity is deep-rooted engineer, I am the engineer, then it hurts me. It causes tremendous pain for me. My identity is there. This is my friend. This is my best friend. So close. But after some time, this so-called best friend doesn't talk to you. Then your identity gets hurt. Identity called friend gets hurt. So like all identities are continuously changing. No identity can be permanent. And holding on to this changing identity as something solid and real causes tremendous problem. And that's why Buddha said, Anatma, the non-self, he referred to this illusory self. There's no Atma. When he spoke of no Atma, the illusory self which we are speaking of. Okay? These all these things what you call as identities. Any identity. I am the body, I am the mind, I am the intellect, I am the husband, I am the wife, I am an engineer, I am a doctor. Any identity is temporary. It cannot be permanent. I am a friend, I am an enemy. All are permanent, temporary identities. Okay? So now holding on to these temporary identities as something permanent causes tremendous suffering for you. So that's why Buddha only said anatta, anatta, anatta means non-self. Don't hold on to anything as permanent. So this is what Buddha meant, anatta. So it is like you can visualize this, a river is flowing. Okay, a flowing river is there. In the flowing river, there's a whirlpool. There's a center which is created. The whirlpool has no real existence. It appears to be there. Okay, it has a function also. It'll suck everything what you throw at it. But it is just a movement in the river. It is nothing solid or permanent. Like that, our identities create a temporary whirlpool in us. That whirlpool is called ego. And this starts sucking everything and causing tremendous turbulence. None of this is going to be permanent. It's all temporary. It will vanish in no time. So this understanding of impermanence of life, anything in life is impermanent, especially the self-identity is impersonal. So now, if self-identity is impersonal, then is there something in me? Am I like a bubble which appears and disappears? there is something more in you than this impermanent identity. So Buddha didn't speak of this self, but all our Vedantic teachings speak of this self, Atman, which is awareness. In fact, Buddha also speaks of this in many places. He calls it as unborn. Okay, he speaks of aja, unborn. The self-awareness or Atma is unborn. So if you recognize yourself as that unborn self, then your suffering will go. And this is the teaching of Vedanta. So the unborn self, which is called awareness, Atma or Shiva Swarupa, I am that. The recognition is called awakening. The awakening is, none of the temporary identities are me. The real me is very different from all this. The real me is never born, never dying. That called Atma, the Shiva Swarupa. So awakening means Naam. Nanimbudu, Nanalla, Yideha, Manabuddhi, Nanalla, Sachidanandatma, Shivanamnani, Shivoham, Shivoham, Shivoham. So this is awakening, is journey from self-identity to self-awareness. Self-identity keeps changing, but self-awareness doesn't change because its awareness is never born. Awareness is eternal. Awareness is infinite. Awareness is auspicious, Shiva Swarupa. So I am that awareness, recognition of this is called awakening. Until you are fully awakened to your real state, real nature, which is Atma, the suffering in life will not go. One kind of suffering or other kind of suffering will come, and we attribute that suffering to this person, this situation, that situation. We have to recognize the divinity in us. That divinity is called Atma. That divinity is called Shiva. That divinity is called consciousness or awareness. Recognize that I am that awareness. So this teaching is what you have to do. This is the understanding of awakening. So we have understood. Are we clear what is awakening is all about? Now, are there stages in awakening? And question is, who is awakening? If everything in me is temporary identity, okay, I listen to something, then that will disappear. Somebody else will appear. So each identity keeps changing. Is there something in me who has to understand this? Who is to awaken from what? What is that awaken? Everything being temporary, who has to awaken? This question comes. And what exactly is the meaning of awakening, and how does the awakening happen? These are the two things we discuss in this class. So what is the meaning of awakening? Who is getting awakened? So for that, the awakening process, what is every awakening? About this, Sri Vidyaranya speaks in Panchadashi. Chapter 7 of Panchadashi, where he speaks of Tripti Deepika or attainment of supreme bliss, Ananda. Attainment of supreme bliss or Tripti Deepika is the topic of Vidyaranya Panchadashi, a beautiful scripture. So here there are 7 stages mentioned about ignorance and awakening. The 7 stages are, First is called Adnana or ignorance. Then Avarana means forgetfulness. Vikshepa means distraction or projection. Parokshadnana means indirect knowledge. Aparokshadnana means direct knowledge. Then what you call as freedom from suffering, dukkha nivritti, and finally tripti or supreme bliss or ananda. These are the seven stages anybody can go through in the process of awakening. So let us understand these seven stages. There were 10 people who were trying to cross a river. 10 people who were trying to cross a river. There was a flood in the river. After crossing the river, they count only 9 people are there. So the 10th person is missing. This causes tremendous amount of sorrow and suffering in the group. One person is missing from our group. So there is an ignorance that nobody has missed. This ignorance is called Adnana. Nobody is missing, but they don't know it. There is ignorance that somebody is missing, and that's called Adnana. So then, the missing person is the person who is counting. He's forgotten to count himself. He's counting the others. There are 9 people. So that's why the forgetting yourself is called Avarana or forgetfulness. So then there is third thing happens. Oh, somebody drowned. Somebody is actually drowned in the river. Somebody is lost. Somebody is dead. Now the mind is projecting Vikshepa. The projection is happening. So first was Adnana, that nobody is missing is not understood. Avarana is I am the missing person is forgotten. Vikshepa is now we are imagining things. Imagining that there is somebody who was drowned in the river and died. So Adnana, Avarana, Vikshepa. So these are the 3 stages of ignorance. Now somebody who was coming near, passerby, first says, nobody is missing. Okay? So the nobody is missing, it is called aparoksha jnana. Indirect knowledge. You are not recognized, nobody is missing. Then he says, count now. You start from counting. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So every 10 is there. The first person who was missing himself also is counted. So there is nobody missing. The 10th person is recognized now directly. Earlier when he says nobody is missing, still you are not convinced. That's called aparoksha jnana or indirect knowledge. Now when you start counting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, all 10 people are there. Now directly you are recognizing that there are 10 people. Always there was 10 people. There's nobody was missing. So this is called aparoksha jnana or direct knowledge. So immediately after effect of aparoksha jnana, immediately there is a dukkha nivritti, shoka nivritti. That means the sorrow is gone. First thing. Then next is what you call as supreme bliss or tripti. All of them feel happy. Now no longer they are searching for somebody. That supreme bliss comes. So this is called tripti. So what are the stages we have gone through? Adnana, Avarana, Vikshepa, Parokshadnana, Aparokshadnana, Dukkha Nivritti and tripti. So these are the 7 stages we go through in realization. Now who goes through the 7 stages? stages, because everything in life is impermanent. My body is impermanent, my mind is impermanent, my intellect is impermanent, society is impermanent, my relationship are impermanent. Who has to recognize the self? Who is there to recognize the self? So that, for that we have to understand that there is an absolute consciousness or supreme reality. We call it a Sadashiva or Parabrahma, which never changes. Sadashiva or Parabrahma, supreme reality. Okay? It's absolute consciousness which never changes. Are you aware of the absolute consciousness? Do you know about it? Yes, you know about it. Whenever you are referring to I, you are always referring to the Parabrahma or supreme reality, Shiva Swarupa. For example, when you say 10 years back I was in Mysuru, now I am in Bangalore, next year I am going to Hubli. Oh my dear, so 10 years back your body was different, your mind was different, your intellect was different. Now your body is different, mind is different, intellect is different, next year also will change. Is there something unchanging in you? Yes. I only was there 10 years back. I only am now here. I will be there in future also. So that means that I doesn't change. Now tell me that I doesn't change. Is there in which part of your body? Is it there in head? Is there in leg? Or is it in chest? Where is it? There is something unchanging in me and there is something changing in me. There is a constantly change in me. I am a mixture of a changing and unchanging. Changing, the unchanging principle I call it is I. Always I refer to I. 10 years back, 20 years back, I. Now also I. Okay, there is a constantly changing part also. Body, mind and intellect. So, what we do is we mix up these two. The changing part and unchanging part. Changing part is and unchanging one. Body, mind and intellect is unchanging and I is not changing. We are mixing up these two. Absolutely and relatively change. Mix. And we put the capturing of the absolute, of the relative and relative of the absolute. Okay? The characteristic of the absolute is consciousness, awareness, existence, consciousness and this. What we call as Sat, Chit, Ananda. The quality of relative is constantly changing. So we superimpose, we mix up these two in our thinking, in our actions, in our day-to-day livings. How do we mix up? You say, I am happy. So here I is there, it's unchanging. Happiness is there, changing. This moment you are happy, next moment you are unhappy. So you are mixing up the changing and unchanging. And this mixing of changing and unchanging is called superimposition. And one who is responsible for this mixing of changing and unchanging is called ego. Okay. So there is a confusion created with ego. This mixing up the changing part and unchanging part. If you really look at it, look at your life, who are you? Are you the changing part or unchanging part? Who are you? Unchanging part. But why are you mixing up with the changing part? Sorry? All the time our and nikshepa is taking place. All the time mixing up is happening. So to come out of the mixing up is called awakening. How do I come out of this mix up which is happening constantly? Every moment is happening. Okay? In waking state, dream state, deep sleep state also is happening. Mixing up is happening. The changing and unchanging are getting mixed up. And this mix up is causing mess in my life. It causes suffering in my life. The body, mind and intellect, my relationships, my friends, nothing can be permanent. But the absolute consciousness, I is permanent. I superimpose on that and I want everything permanent in my life. I want a permanent good friend. I want a permanent relative. I want a permanent customer. I want everything permanent in life. While nothing is permanent. So you are taking the characteristic of the absolute, which is I, and putting it on the relative. Same time you are taking the relative and putting on the absolute. I am happy, I am unhappy, I am suffering, I am joyful, I want this, I don't want this. All are related to the relative. That you are putting on the absolute. So this mix-up is happening, and this mix-up is causing the confusion in our life. The teaching of Vedanta is you can come out of this mix-up. Come out of this mixing up which is happening and become free. And that is called awakening. How do we avoid this mix-up? Now, you cannot physically separate them. There's no surgery by which you can do that. If I had a knife or surgery, I can cut the relative and change the absolute. It doesn't happen that way. It has to happen through Shuddha, pure Jnana. Jnana alone can liberate. This is the teaching of Upanishad. No amount of sadhana can help you. Because all sadhana are in the relative domain. Every sadhana is in the domain of the relative. You cannot get the absolute by the doing effort in the relative. Any kind of sadhana cannot take you to the absolute. Then what can take you to the absolute? Is only through jnana. A clarity which emerges in you. So that can alone take. So that's why Bhagavad Gita says, Nahi jnanena sadrisham pavitramhe mudyate. Nothing is more purifying than jnana, atmajnana, self-knowledge. The self-knowledge alone can free us from this missing or mix-up which is happening in our life. There's no other way. Now, shall I sit and meditate for 10,000 hours? You can calm your mind. You can make your mind calm. You can calm. But that atmajnana is not result of the calming of the mind. Now, shall I do some good service? Definitely, your mind will become purified. But atmajnana is not that. Whether meditation or service, what we call karma yoga or bhakti yoga or kriya yoga, are they required? Definitely, they are required to make your mind calm and peaceful. But atmajnana has to take you beyond the mind to your true nature, to your self. So which requires jnana? Karma yoga, bhakti yoga, kriya yoga, all these yogas help to purify the mind and prepare you for jnana. And atma jnana alone can take you to the level where you can confidently understand that I am pure consciousness, sure spoken. So that clarity has to come. So I told you the seven stages: ajnana, avarana, vikshepa, parokshadnana, aparokshadnana, and dukkha nivritti and trati. So these seven stages you can go through. Now, who goes through these seven stages? Absolute will never go through. The absolute or Shiva Swarupa will never undergo any changes. That's why it's absolute. If absolute undergoes changes, then you have a problem. The absolute will never undergo any changes. In the absolute, the relative appears like a dream appears, and this dream of the absolute is called Maya. The dream appears in the absolute. In the Maya, the world appears, your body appears, your mind appears, your intellect appears. So dream of consciousness is called Maya. The dream doesn't affect the consciousness. The dream of consciousness is called Maya. So in that dream, all of us appear. So the moment we appear, we also get some consciousness in us. The moment I am born, there's a consciousness associated with me. Right? When you are born to your mother, how many children are born really? When you are born to your mother, have you ever thought how many children are really born to your mother at a point of time when you are born? Any idea? Father and mother give a body to the child. So there's a biological father and biological mother give a physical body. But the physical body is nothing actually. The body has to be getting the consciousness. The consciousness didn't come from the physical. The consciousness came from the Shiva and Shakti, Divine Mother and Divine Father. So your body was filled with consciousness, and that consciousness is called Divine Child. The Divine Child is called Chidabhasa in Vedanta. The Divine Child filled up the human child to make it alive. The Shiva entered into you as Chidabhasa or consciousness. So how many children are there now? How many parents are there now? Two biological parents, father and mother, and two father and mother, divine father and mother, Shiva and Shakti, four parents over here. Right? So that's not the end of it. Now, slowly society starts getting in. The mother comes and talks to the child, the father comes and talks to the child, grandfather comes and talks to the child, the television, the child watches television, child watches the society, friends come, teachers come, the society comes into picture. Religion comes into picture, politics comes into picture. Now the third child is born, it's called mind. Okay? So first child is divine father and mother, Shiva and Shakti. The second child is biological father and mother. The third child is society child, it's called mind. How many fathers are there and mothers are there for society child? N numbers. Everybody in the society contributes something in your idea. So if you look at your mind, the mind is a full contribution from the society. The body is contribution from parents, the consciousness is contribution from the Shiva Shakti, the mind is contribution from the society. The society child has many fathers and many mothers. All our suffering in life comes from the society child. I am worried. Who is worried really? The society child. I am unhappy. Who is unhappy? The society child. I am suffering. Who is suffering? The society child. I have a leg pain. Whose child is this? The biological child. I am hungry. The biological child. Okay. I am blissful, peaceful. Who is that? Divine child. So there are three children in us. Okay. So the first divine child is called Chidabhasa or consciousness, reflected consciousness from the universal consciousness. Divine child is exactly same as the universal consciousness. Are you clear? So now, but when these three children come together, the divine child forgets the universal father and mother, and it starts associating the society child and the human child. It starts believing that I am a part of the society child and human child. It's just forgotten. The avarana has come to the divine child, not for the human child or the society child. Human child and society child don't have the ability. Okay? So when we teach, I am pure consciousness, we are making the divine child remember that I am the child of the divine, Shiva Swarupa. Okay? Right now I am associating the body and mind because the confusion created with the mind, ego. So I have to remember my true nature. So this divine child is called Chidabhasa in Vedanta. Okay? The teaching that I am not the body, I am not the mind, I am not the intellect is for the divine child, which has forgotten its nature and associates with the body and mind. Who are you really? Are you the society child? Are you the human child? You are the divine child because I in you has never changed. The society child constantly undergoes change. The body undergoes change. But has I in you changed? that unchanging I is the divine child because it's connected to the universal consciousness or supreme consciousness, Shiva Swarupa, Brahma Swarupa. For that child, the teaching is there. What is the teaching? Naan, Nanembudu, Nanalla, Ideha, Manabuddhi, Nanalla, Sajidanandatma, Shivananani, Shivoham, Shivoham, Shivoham. So the remembrance has to happen to the divine child. Otherwise, it's so immersed in this drama which is going on with the society child and human child. Okay? So, the first step is Chida Ajnana. Ajnana is for whom? This combination of divine child, society child, human child. Because the whole drama is happening here. Okay? Ajnana, what is Ajnana? I don't know, is there Brahman or God or Shiva? I don't know. Absolute consciousness is there? I don't know. Okay? Brahma Swarupa is there? I don't know. There's absolute consciousness? I don't know about all those things. So that's called Ajnana. So then comes Avarana. I have forgotten that I am divine child. Even if you tell that you are Shiva Swarupa, you can't accept it. How can I be? Because according for you, the Shiva Swarupa, Shiva means somebody is staying in Kailasa with this vehicle. So you have concept of society is given a lot of Shiva Swarupa. The real Shiva Swarupa is forgotten. Avarana is there. Your own nature is forgotten for the Chidabhasa. Then there is a Vikshepa. Vikshepa means distraction. What is the distraction? I am the body, I am the mind, I am the intellect, I am limited, I am bound by karma, I am suffering, I am happiness, I am happy, I am unhappy, I am so and so. So this identity gets created. This is called Vikshepa. Ajnana, Avarana, Vikshepa. Then comes the Parokshadnana. Parokshadnana means indirect teaching. Indirect teaching is given by the scriptures, Upanishads. The Upanishads come back again and say, you are that, Tattvamasi. You are that. First you have to understand and accept the teaching of Upanishad. Okay? That teaching has to be learned from the master, guru. So you have to have faith in the master and the teaching to get the Parokshadnana. Otherwise you will say, no, this doesn't work for me. Then comes the Aparokshadnana. So the guru has taught you, you are Shiva Swarupa. But that is still indirect knowledge. It is not my experience. From that indirect knowledge, it has to become direct knowledge. What is that? I am Shiva Swarupa. Shivoham. That clarity has to emerge. Okay? Once that clarity emerges, then you are very, very clear that I am Shiva Swarupa. Just like you are clear now, I am the father, son of father and mother. Okay? You are very, very clear that I am the divine child. I am one with my father, which is consciousness. This is what Jesus Christ said, I and my father are one. In Bible, Jesus Christ says, I and my father are one. So teaching for that comes from the Tattvamasi, you are that. And then your recognition happens. That recognition comes, I am that. I am that consciousness. I am that I am. I am Shiva Swarupa. So this comes in Bible also. In Bible, the Moses goes on to a mountain, a holy mountain. There he gets 10 commandments. And there's a light which appears in front of him. He asks that light, who are you? That light says, I am that I am. Actually, that is a Sanskrit translation of Soham Asmi. Shivoham, that translation is that. So the Shivoham, Aham Brahmasmi, when it becomes very, very clear to you, free from any doubt, then you have awakened. That's called Aparokshadnana. Who is that who is awakened? Not the society child, not the biological child, It is a divine child, understood, oh, these are all play of a society child and human child. I am divine child. That recognition happens for the Chidabhasa. It recognition happens only through society child and human child, because listening has to happen, Shravana has to happen. But recognition happens, I am the divine child. The society child is not permanent, the human child is not permanent, but the divine child is permanent. So that divine child which got confused by the society child, human child, is being taught. What is the teaching? You are Shiva Swarupa. You are divine. That teaching has to be recognized by the divine child. It is not that he has to become divine child. It's already divine child. It is only forgotten because of avarana and vikshepa. When the divine child, it forgets that I am divine, it associates the body and mind. It's called jiva. When it associates with the consciousness, it becomes Shiva. Shiva is jiva and jiva is Shiva. That clarity has to emerge in our understanding through the teaching of the master. And the teaching has to go deep inside, cannot be surface level, cannot be superficial, it has to go deep inside. And that awakening happens through jnana. That's called aparoksha jnana. So that now the divine child feels, understands, I am Shiva Swarupa. Aham Brahmasmi is the clarity. Shivoham, Tattvamasi has become now Aham Brahmasmi. Okay. Now even Aham Brahmasmi is a word. Okay, but that word is only for communication purpose. Really your inner understanding has to open up. I am Shiva Swarupa. That clarity has to emerge. The society child will confuse you. How can you be Shiva Swarupa? You are that idiot who born there. Okay, you are so and so. The society child will confuse you. That confusion from the society child has to be overcome to recognize I am the divine child. So that is called aparoksha jnana. Now you are very clear, Aham Brahmasmi, I am Shiva Swarupa. You are very, very confident, there is no doubt. As clear that you are a son of father and mother, you are clear that you are the divine child, you are Shiva Swarupa. That clarity has to come. Until that clarity comes, awakening has not happened. There is a vagueness, there is a confusion, it is still not there. So then the moment it happens, Dukkha Nivritti, all suffering will go. You recognize that the suffering is superimposed on me, imposed on me by the society child and human child, there's nothing to do with me. I am free from this suffering. That clarity has to emerge. Once that clarity happens, there's a supreme bliss. It's called Trati. I am Satchidananda Swarupa. Existence, consciousness, bliss is I am. So that recognition gives you freedom from complete suffering. So this happens to Chidabhasa or reflected consciousness or manifest consciousness or the divine child in you. This is the spiritual awakening which has stages. Ajnana or ignorance. Avarna means forgetfulness. Vikshepa means distraction or projection. Okay. Paroksha Jnana means indirect knowledge through Guru. Aparoksha Jnana means direct recognition of self by you. Dukkha Nivritti means freedom from suffering. And Trapti or recognition of blissful establishment is bliss. It's called Ananda. So these are the stages. In awakening. So, is that clear? Now, this awakening, the awakening also is explained in seven stages in Yoga Vasishta. The seven stages of awakening, Sri Yoga Maharshi Vasishtha Ruchi explained to Sri Ramachandra the seven stages of awakening in a different way. Okay. So these seven stages are called Yoga Jnana Bhumika or stages of Jnana. Rishi Ramachandra undergoes depression. After his education, he goes on travel. They had an education tour after their studies in Gurukula. He goes and sees all over the country. The idea of education tour is to get exposure to the society. And sees everywhere there is suffering, everywhere there is pain, everywhere there is an unhappiness. Seeing this, Rama gets depressed. Is that all life is about? So for that, Vasishtha Rishi gives the teaching to Rama, and this teaching is called Yoga Vasishtha. In Yoga Vasishtha, Vasishtha Rishi gives the 7 stages of awakening, or called Jnana Bhumika. They are Shubhecha, Vicharana, Tanumanasi, Sattopati, Asamasakti, Padartha Abhavana, and Turyala. There are 7 stages which are told to Sri Ramachandra. What are those 7 stages? Let us understand. First stage is called Shubhecha. Maharshi Yoga Vasishtha Maharshi tells Ramachandra, O Rama, at a very young age, you have got depression. Okay? And your depression is not because you are suffering, but you see the suffering in the world. Everywhere there is suffering in the world. And you understood the nature of life from the suffering. So you want to know how to get out of this suffering. Is there a way out of this suffering? This is called Shubhecha. Shubha means the desire for ultimate good. See, we say a marriage ceremony is there, Shubhakarya. A Upanayanam is there, Shubhakarya. A childbirth is there, Shubhakarya. They are all relatively Shubha, auspicious. But what is ultimate Shubha for us is how to become free from suffering. So you have got a desire for the ultimate. It's called Shubhecha. Is there a way I can come out of this suffering? Is there a way I can become free from this suffering? That question comes to very few people. Not even 0.1% of the population. Most of the people in the world, for them, they don't understand the nature of suffering. Sri Ramakrishna Paramahansa says, a dog chews the bone. Dog chews the bone, and while chewing the bone, the blood starts oozing from the bone. The dog is very happy sucking that blood, without knowing that the blood is coming from its own mouth. Okay? So that Sri Ramakrishna Paramahansa is an example for the nature of the world. For most of the people, or bulk of the society, we don't even get an idea that life is suffering. We keep on constantly trying to improve the situation. That doesn't work out. Because the life is impermanent. Life is constantly changing. So that changing life, you cannot get a permanent happiness out of that. It's very difficult. This doesn't go. People don't understand this. And they create a self-identity out of that. I am so and so. And try to hold on to the self-identity at any cost. And that causes more suffering, more harm. There is no way to get out of this vicious circle. For some people, very fortunate few, they are able to recognize this nature of life. Very, very rare are those souls. Why did they become like this? Why did they recognize this? Because of many janmas, they have done some good karma. Some good karma they have done. Knowingly or unknowingly, and because of that good karma, they are able to recognize the real nature of life. That is not sufficient. Recognize the real nature of life is not sufficient. You have to have hope that I can come out of this mess which is like called life. Okay, then they start seeking answer. How do I get to that? And how do I come out of this? How do I come out of this suffering in life? So that question comes to very few people, and that question is called Shubhechha, the desire for ultimate good. Sri Shankara says, very rare indeed is human life. Human life is not easy, it's rare. Because there are 84 million types of living beings. Out of that, human being is only one type. Very rare is human life. In human life, it is very difficult. Difficult for somebody to recognize the nature of life itself. That is rare indeed. Out of those who recognize the nature of life, very few people struggle to get out of that mess or get out of this suffering. Very few people. That is also very rare. Even those very few people who want to get out of the suffering, to get them a real Mahapurusha or great being who can help them, guide them to get out of suffering, a master can help them to get out of suffering, it's very difficult to get, rare indeed. And even if you get, after getting the master, only very few people really are able to understand the teaching and get out of suffering. That's why Shri Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Bahunam Janmanamante Dnanavan Ma Prapadyate Vasudeva Sarvamiti Sa Mahatma Sa Durlabha. After many many lives of lifetimes of effort, we get such a rare fortune. And that's why it's called Shubhechha, or the desire for ultimate good. So that's the first stage. Shubhechha, by grace, by your good karma, comes in very 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 few people. So that's called first stage. Then comes the start, the vicharana. Now how do I get out of this mess? How do I get out of this suffering? The enquiry has to start. Okay, this is called vicharana. So vicharana is, how do I get out of suffering? So far I have blamed so many people of my life for my suffering. That person is responsible for my suffering. This person is responsible for my suffering. I have come to a stage to understand this suffering is because of my inner nature, not because of somebody else. My understanding has to correct. I have to discover who am I? Who am I? Koha was me? So Sri Ramana Maharshi teaches this as, who are you? So that question comes to very few people. This is called vicharana. Now, can I do vicharana if I sit one place and keep on asking, who am I, answer will come. The same answer will come from the society child, because society child will give very nice answers. Okay? You are such and such a great person, you are such and such a beautiful person, most wonderful person on the earth. Okay? So the society child will come with nice answers. But you have to come out of this social conditioning, the society child conditioning. Who am I? That question has to be answered. Now that question doesn't have an answer in the sense the society child cannot answer that. Because society child answers can answer only in the domain of known. The who am I, the answer is not in the domain of known. It's a pure consciousness. It's a pure silence. It's ultimate bliss. That answer cannot come from the society child. So you need to get support. The support is called scriptures, the teaching of the masters, Upanishads. Then you need a support from the master, realized master, who can help you. Now who is the realized master? That question comes. Shrotriyam Brahmanishtam, one who is realized himself and one who is able to communicate the realization to you. In such a way, it doesn't violate the scriptures, because anybody can come and say anything. Ultimately, it has to be in line with the teaching of the other realized masters. So such a person can become a realized master. Then Sri Ramana Maharshi has asked this question, who is the realized master? Then Ramana Maharshi said, in whose presence you will feel peaceful. in whose presence all your questions vanish, not that you get an answer from questions. All your questions become irrelevant. Such a person is the master. So, when I start the inquiry, I need scriptures. It's called Vicharana. From Shubhecha, I have come to Vicharana stage, inquiry stage. Who am I? The scriptures are support, the master is support, master is guidance. Under this, the inquiry starts. And how the inquiry has to happen? Shri Krishna tells in Bhagavad Gita, Tadvitti pranipatena pariprasnena parisevaya upadekshanti te jnanam jnaninah tattva darshinah. Tadvitti pranipatena, surrender to the master. Now what is this surrender to the master is, drop your ego, because it's not easy for us to surrender to the master. Tadvitti pranipatena, surrender. Pariprasnena, ask the questions. What questions? The questions about yourself. How I can get out of the suffering? Who am I? Related questions. Not the questions of the politics, not the questions of the society, not the questions of the family, not the questions of the children. But who am I? What can help me to get out of this question, identity, what I have? So those questions you have to have. Pariprasnena. Parisevaya. Service you have to do. What is the service? Service to the master is service of jnana. So whatever jnana he is giving, for that service. Upadekshati te jnanam, jnaninaha tattva darshinaha. One who has realized will give you jnana with a clarity, with a conviction, which will start bringing you the wisdom. This is actually called, now you have come to Vicharana stage. Vicharana stage involves Shravana and Manana. So now comes to the next stage. From first stage was Shubhecha. Second stage is called Vicharana. Third stage comes Tanumanasi. Tanumanasi means, Manasu means mind. Tanu means like a thread. Mind becomes subtle now. Mind becomes sukshma. The mind is very gross for all of us. The mind which goes outwards to the society is very, very gross. The mind which has to go towards the self becomes subtle, subtle, subtle. Because now you are inquiring into the nature of self, which is the subtler than subtlest. Okay? See, if I think of an elephant, my mind has to take the shape of the elephant. If I think of the earth, my mind has to think the shape of the earth. If I have to think of the self, mind has to become very, very, very subtle. The gross mind cannot help. So, from Shubhecha to Vicharana, Shravana has happened. Now, Manana has to happen. In the Manana stage, what will happen is, your mind starts becoming very subtle. It's called subtle stage of the mind. It's called Tanu Manasi. Now, you will be able to understand very, very subtle aspect of life. Otherwise, our mind is stuck to the gross aspect of life. Very, very gross. This subtle aspect of life, the develops in you, it's called Tanumanasi. Tanumanasi stage, the mind is constantly going towards the self, again and again. It's called Manana stage, Shravana and Manana. So Atma has not understood properly. I have not understood Atma. I have not understood Shiva Swarupa. But I am trying to understand it, internalize it. Okay? In that process, mind becomes subtle. Right? Now this process of internalization is called Savikalpa Samadhi. So now you have developed the concepts about the self. I am Shiva Swarupa, you have started developing concepts. It's not reality. So that concept is called Savikalpa Samadhi. From Tanumanasi stage, we'll start moving into Sattvapati. Sattvapati means now you are establishing in the truth. Okay? Establishment in the truth becomes reality. How do you establish in the truth? By Viveka and Vairagya. Discrimination and dispassion. There is no other way for truth. There are two types of Viveka, Nitya Anitya Viveka.